The only thing that we're lacking now is for Supernature to give us its calling card, its invitation, give us its invitation. And when that occurs, of course, we're going to, we're the audience for that. We're the audience. Supernature is the performer. We are the audience. When we get the invitation to Supernature, we realize we don't need to do any planning. There's no planning needed there. And this is why we're practicing the full stop in the wow. To be an audience member, to be an audience member. We don't need to be performers anymore. Not at this juncture. It's time to let the inherent nature of God, the true nature, let that be the performer. Let us be the audience. So what we're doing here is really, fundamentally, we're practicing to be an audience member. And really we'll be, quote unquote, speechless, but more to the point, futureless, thought-free, future-free, stunned, staggered, but you can still talk. Even when we do this full stop, I can still use speech, but it's like my mind is there's no thinking going on, or at least we're full stopping in this wow, so there's very little thinking going on. It's very important. An audience member is not there to think. The audience member is there to experience, right? So, for instance, we're not a performer, we're not a critic. Invitation to Supernature arrives in this world, which it has every right to do, every right to do so. We invite it. I invite it, certainly. We all invite it in the invitation. It would be very rude not to give us an invitation. After all, this is an option, a super important option that we have. So the invitation arrives here, and we realize we're not the performer here. The invitation is the one that's the performer. This is the one on the stage. We're in the audience, and also we're not critics. We're not saying, okay, let me think. Oh, what do I like? What do I don't like? Let me start forming a criticism in my mind. You see, that's not the point of it, right? The point of it is to see, do you like it? Do you accept it? You know, and more to the point, get used to it. Get familiar with it. Get familiar with it. Also, you're not comparing it. Say, imagine if you were at a performance and it was just this incredible performance, just wonderful. And you're sitting there and you say, wow, this is just wonderful. You know what? This is so much better than that terrible performance I heard last week. That was so awful. I remember the music was I just couldn't stand this. It made me so agitated and upset. And I was thinking, all the while, you're getting all agitated thinking about the performance that you don't like, and you're completely missing the one where you are. So this is why, again, full stopness is so important. Don't let the mind go anywhere, pro or con. And this way, then, we simply are allowing familiarity to take place. So we don't say, hey, this is a really great performance. You know what? I think it could be even better if it's like this or like that or like that. See, that too takes us out of familiarity. We're disassociating from the moment, the familiarity of the moment. So, an invitation to Supernature has every right to... We have every right to be invited. It's the alternative. It's the alternative, actually, to the incorporation of this planet. Into central planning. Central planning for what? The future. Which is really just exacerbating our fear of annihilation. In the guise of finding a solution to it. Very tricky, isn't it? So, the invitation to Supernature, it can come within us, can't it? Absolutely it can. And this is when we need to be quiet mind, full stop in the now. getting little glimpses that, hey, we don't need the future. We don't need time. We don't need time. We don't need planning. Life is not something actually that's actually planned at all. Our true life. Here, what we call life is really death. It's really death. Or an attempt to die. Let's put it that way. An attempt to die. We deserve this invitation, and so we can get it within us. We can also have something seemingly external to us also that can happen. Or it can be a combination of those factors, an invitation to supernature. This is what we're waiting for. Of course, Jesus gave an invitation to supernature. Absolutely. He said, this is not my place. This place here? This is the kingdom of death. Are you kidding me? This is the kingdom of nonsense, silliness, belief in disempowerment, fear of annihilation. This is not. So I'm going to my Father's home, you know? So, and inviting us all, come along, eternal life. Come along to eternal life. Take the road to eternal life. Accept eternal life. So there's an example. That's invitation to supernature. There's been other invitations to supernature too. And this is what is so important. This forms the backbone of religious belief. That there, you know, there's eternal life somewhere for us. This is the backbone. And this is what the CCC, Cosmic Corporate Culture, is. Or cultists, you might call them. Cosmic Corporate Cultists, actually. Are trying to get rid of. How dare anybody have this thought of, you know, somewhere there's eternal life and I have can have access to it, and, you know, how dare anybody think that way? And therefore their eyes are on the prize and they're not really too concerned about this world. You know, this, because the CCC, the whole point of it is to believe this world, we have to make this world equal, more attractive than something else. It has to be all attractive to us. We must be fundamentally attracted to it. So they're very much fundamentalists in terms of wanting to be fundamentally attracted to the body, this world, the world of form, time, space, process, and form, to the point where there isn't any attraction, any more attraction to anything else. So the idea of someone saying, I'm attracted to eternal life, I believe there's a heavenly realm, so they say, no, that's wrong, that's bad, that's violation of church and state, that's, you know, this is their ideology. And this is what this planet is being incorporated into. Central planning, keep everybody working on the future of trying to make this world more attractive to us, to spirit, than reality. Home is to spirit. They don't state it that way because they refuse to admit there is even any competition at all. They say, no, this is it. This is the only place there is, so it would be crazy not to try and make it attractive. So they don't want anyone thinking along the lines of, hey, I really feel like I'm attracted to something way, way better than this situation here. So I'm not really worried about trying to make this situation here more attractive or anything like that. Just let it be the way that it is. I don't really have my attention on it. And they don't want that taught. They don't want that disseminated. And they are absolutely gung-ho on seeing that this is the way that it is here in this world. And they certainly are getting their way, that's for sure. So the invitation to supernature is the option to such a world. It's the option to such a situation. Not fighting this cosmic corporate culture, which has a great many it's really in charge of the power structure of this planet now. And they have the ways and the means to suppress dissent. So I don't see that fighting is the way. For me, the invitation to supernature is where I want to put my attention and saying, and just to get used to it. Invitation to supernature is basically saying, here's something to get used to and see if you like it. You know, if you like it, this is an option for you. It doesn't say you must go. It just says, here's an option for you. See if you like it. See if you can get familiar with this. See if you can get familiar with it. Remember, familiarity is the key. So we cannot just keep it at the conceptual level, because that doesn't give us any familiarity in an experiential feeling way at all, does it? So we cannot just let it be stale and say, well, let's just talk about. We actually need the invitation to experience it. That's the only way we can get familiar. One of the only ways. And of course, also we can trigger glimpses of freedom and glimpses of our true nature within us. And then practice full stop in the wow, which is what we're working on here in preparation. So we are all audience members. It's the supernature is the guru. We're the devotees. Supernature is the performer. We're the audience. So I'm not a guru or a teacher or anything like that. I'm an audience member. All I'm doing is advising, saying, hey, here's some advice of how to be an audience member. Yeah. So we don't dissociate from it. It's easy to do, because once we, if our fear, continuity fear is still very severe, we'll still think we need to make this world like more attractive than to us than reality. So if we get a glimpse of supernature, invitation to supernature, we'll feel so inspired, say, wow, I get this sort of a feeling of paradise, and say, okay, now let me translate this into action, into making this world more attractive than that. You know, now I get some ideas, and then you go to work and, you know, you're lost to the familiarity of the invitation, actually. This is the big trouble. It's very big, difficult trouble. This is what I've had to battle through. This is why this practice, full stop in the wow, full stop as an audience member. Just remain as an audience member. The audience members don't get up out of it. It's like you're seeing something great, you know, in the performance. Wow. You don't say, oh, wow, this is great. Let me get up and go home and start practicing, you know, my performance. I'm inspired. I need to go practice my performance. No, you stay with the performance. This is a, you know, analogy that we can use. You're there to get the full familiarity with the performance. The longer you stay, the better, the more familiar you are. So you can feel, hey, you know what? I could handle another performance like this. But if within the first, you know, as the performance is going on, if we just say, hey, I'm really inspired, I want to go work on my performance, get up and leave, you miss the familiarity that you could get. So full stop in the wow is stay seated, in other words. Don't spring into action. No matter how wonderful what you're experiencing is, you continue just to stay, to sit there. Jesus showed up right here in front of me. I just continue to sit here. I wouldn't say, wow, I feel like, wow, I gotta go tell everybody. Let me get up and go call people on the phone, you know, and take pictures, and let me send those pictures. And I just stay sitting here. Just stay sitting here, committed to being an audience member. This is how I see how we attract the invitation to supernature, is we're very good audience members, very good at being an audience. So, sitting quietly, even though your mind is fired with tremendous hope and freedom, is the key. And just full stop that. When we come across something that is so beautiful, we rarely do in this world, don't we? But for example, if we did, we just like are speechless. Just wow, all speech is gone. And what's happening? All planning is gone, isn't it? All thinking, planning the future we call time, psychological time, is gone. Because we say this is good enough for me right here. This is all I need right here. And so you just like you feel like in a timeless, speechless, timeless, thought-free, time-free, just wow. And you don't even know how long you've been standing there, right? Or viewing something beautiful. Just you lose sense of time, don't you? You lose sense of time and place. You don't even know where you are. Somebody asked you where, I don't know where I am. You know how long you've been standing here? No, I don't really know. Because, see, this is what happens. So you have to be, you practiced at this, practice this. And the more practiced you are, the more tremendous the invitation is. And you're not thinking of doing anything in that state. You're not thinking of, I need to paint a picture of this. I want to go paint. What if I want to go paint? Or I want to go tell somebody else about it. Or I want to take a picture. Or I want to write some poetry. Or I want to write a book about how I managed to get to where I am now. Or no, you're not even thinking about any plans at all. You're just enjoying what you're seeing, what you're experiencing. Case, what we're experiencing is absolute freedom of our true nature. A symbol of it, in terms of supernature, is a symbol of it. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. So it's not, it's something that makes us forget the world, actually, this world of flesh, and this fake attractions of the flesh. We're not dependent on nature for any sense of acknowledgement of what I am. Of course, nature is never static, is it? Never static. It's always cycles. Always cycling, always changing. We're not dependent on that. Our identity is not dependent on any sort of acknowledgement from that at all. In fact, our identity is not dependent on acknowledgement, any type of acknowledgement. It's inherently self-acknowledged. So back to this invitation of supernature. Now, so we have like about 16 days before January 1st, 2015. So it's coming upon us very rapidly right now, especially with the Christmas holidays. This is why it's important to push this very much so, where you accept, I will be an audience member at some point, an audience member, all of us, an audience member. simple. Realizing that we have a severe continuity problem. So it's a struggle, it's a shock to us. Getting an invitation to Supernature is a shock to us for sure. It's a wow, very big wow. Now, invitation to Supernature can and have happened in this world. They absolutely have. So they can happen again. Absolutely, they can happen again. And we can get those within us too. Absolutely. The more we expect it, the more we practice it, the closer we get to actually getting the invitation. Because we're not going to then spin it into trying to, as motivation to try to make this world, nature, this realm, more attractive than Supernature, which is our habitual familiarity of what we're actually doing. That's why we have these robotic bodies, biorobots we call bodies. This is why we're paying attention to what these biorobots are doing in this nature place. That's why we're paying attention to it. We feel that there's some mandate from God to do this, and of course that's our fundamental mistake. There's no mandate whatsoever. God is not telling us this is what we need to do. God doesn't say what we need to do at all, except inherently we are absolute freedom. So we function as absolute freedom. That's the only necessity there is. There is no co-necessity. So as we go towards the end of this year, we need to recap. I pretty much said everything I need to say. And it said, you know, practice. Keep the pressure on here. Raise the expectations. Get the expectations so that, you know, the pressure is we need to practice. Certainly, those who don't practice will be caught unawares. The invitation to Supernature, they'll be, whoa, I didn't expect it to, you know, wow, I'm not prepared. You don't want to be unprepared. I believe that Jesus, a lot of his parables and what he said was basically telling us, don't be caught unprepared. That is basically, he said it over and over in many different ways, don't be caught unprepared. At the end of the cycle, don't be caught unprepared. There's an invitation, there's an opportunity to be had. Now, there's any role I play, it would just be an example of being a good audience member, good member of the audience. This is how you. It's possible to do it. We can do it. And just share advice on that. So get used to dropping various expressions and expressiveness in this world. You don't want to immediately turn, oh. And say, let me, I'm inspired now, I want to write a bunch of songs, I want to perform a bunch of songs, I feel like singing, I feel like doing all this. Now, because the invitation of Supernature is so tremendous, you don't want to take your attention off of it. And so if you're disciplined, if you've practiced being disciplined, oh, I'm not going to do anything, except just sit here quietly, and the wow, full stop in the wow, then you will then spend your time getting familiar with it, with the invitation to Supernature, death-free realm. So having been through all those mistakes myself, I understand the mistakes that others are making. Not judging them, just understanding it. Remember, there's nothing we need to do to create Supernature. There's nothing we need to do to sustain it. Nothing we need to do to maintain it. Absolutely nothing we need to do. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. I need do nothing. Except get familiar with it. So, sitting quietly, committed to not getting up, is a super powerful practice, actually. This is what I'm sharing with the world to practice this. Of course, those who don't do this have all sorts of rationalizations. That's how the ego, quote unquote, the ego, the defensiveness is all about rationalizing the chasing after futility due to the continuity fear. If you accept that I have a severe continuity fear, severe lack of familiarity, then you can use your spiritual will and discipline yourself, because you know what you're addressing here. You don't let the rationalizations in. You don't let them in. You say, no, not now. Not now. Not right now, I'm busy. Spiritual will say, not now. Don't get in arguments. That's how you fail. You just say, full stop. Not now. Not now. Is this the vision of oneness? No. Drop it. As you start a concatenation, which means linking thoughts together like in a storyline, you start a storyline, start to, well, catch it, drop it. Don't try to find what the conclusion of the storyline is, or don't use the storyline to figure out a nice ending to the storyline of how do I get to dropping it through the story. No, just drop it this instant. That spiritual will, just drop it. In other words, you drop the dreaming. You don't wait. You don't try to keep the dreaming going until there's some hero, heroine, some plot that gets to somehow stop the dreaming, because that goes on and on and on. You just drop it this instant. Not now. Maybe later, not now. So this is the key I've been sharing. So you say, maybe later, but not now. Not now. You have a try to come back. Maybe later, but not now. I'm busy. Not now. Again, when we get to see the invitation, experiencing the invitation, it's really an invitation to sanity, invitation to our home, which is sanity. We realize we don't need to plan. Life isn't dependent on planning the future. Life is always completely eternal. Always eternal life. Always. There's no way it cannot be so. It's absolutely impossible for us to lose our identity, lose our true nature of eternal life. Everything is eternal life. Everything is actually just the dance of pure potentiality. Without pure potentiality, losing what it is in the slightest bit by any dance whatsoever. So, it's just the dance of God. All is the dance of God always. All is eternal life always. Because anything that arises, supposedly we call it apparent crystallization, but nothing crystallizes. Whatever it is that is being experienced can be experienced again and again and again forever without ever any degrading or any residue. So it's eternal. Every experience is eternal. All is eternal life, always. And SuperNature reminds us of this. You look at SuperNature, and you realize nothing has ever died. There's no trace of residue, of decay, of getting old. It seems like it's being refreshed, actually, every moment. Each moment chooses the same, chooses the same. This is, I was taken to the supernatural realm. And it's shown what it's like. And that was a huge wow. In fact, it was such a huge wow, I was not able to stay there at that time. So I've been working on it ever since. I realized that I have a deficiency there. It's like a continuity issue, for sure. And this, of course, reminds us that all is eternal life, always. There's nothing that is not eternal life, even here in this world, but this world is designed to hide this from us. It's a hiding place. This world is designed like a hiding place from truth. Even though it's not hidden to truth at all, we believe it is. We have a very strong belief, and it seems that way to us. It feels that way to us. Because we feel everything's determinate. This nature, it's somehow independently changing, independent of our will, our desire to have, our desire for experiencing. It's not actually anything independent, but it seems to be independent because we identify with these bodies, you see, thinking this is our identity. That fools us, tricks us. Imagine if someone came an imitation to SuperNature arrived in this world in some way. Maybe it's associated with some body that agreed to just provide a focal point for it, and we're feeling it. Here we realize, it's a huge field. It's this marvelous invitation. Well, imagine if it met those who simply sat quietly like this, with discipline, and full stop in the wow, and that's it. No questions, no criticism, no questions, no thinking, just wow, full stop on the wow. Well, that would be marvelous. That's what the invitation is looking for. But how many of us on this planet are so disciplined and practiced? You can't just get this disciplined overnight. You can't become a virtuoso on the piano with your first lesson, okay? This doesn't happen that way. And those who don't practice, self-deception tells them, just work on convincing everyone that you are a virtuoso, even though you're not. That's easier, you see. It's faster. But if you're trying to convince SuperNature that you're practiced in full stop in the wow, and you're arguing and say, "Hey, SuperNature, the imitation, I'm doing everything just right, but I'm not feeling quite. It's not quite right. So you're doing it wrong. You're doing it wrong, you see." And then you try to convince that it needs to change its imitation to fit you. In other words, let's say you have this you advertise this concert, and you say you're going to perform this concert, and everybody, the audience arrives, and you come up there and say, "Okay, everybody," and you've never played piano, you don't know even how to play it, never practiced really, and you clunk clunk, the audience is going to go, "Huh?" Stand up and say, "Hey, where's the applause?" The audience, "What? What's going on here?" Then you say, "Hey, you stupid audience, what's the matter with you? How come you're not applauding this?" And the audience goes, "Well, applaud what?" said, what are you talking about, Cloud? Well, I just gave this command, the virtuoso command for us. I'm a virtuoso, you know. The audience says, I don't think so. What is this? Oh, you know. No, you just don't know how to hear properly. Your sensibilities are all wrong. You know, what I played was absolutely fabulous. And so you're a lousy, terrible audience. Get out of here, you know. It was like that. So, if we're not practiced, that's the attitude we'll get into. We'll feel confrontational with the invitation to supernature. Instead of just being quiet. Instead of being quiet, we be confrontational and get into mentally arguing, you know, emotionally arguing, mentally arguing, and you know, it's a big confrontational situation. They need to win, triumph over, or convince them, you know, you're right or something. Instead of here, no, I'm just an audience member practicing this full stop and go, wow, this invitation is absolutely fabulous. I'm not going to do anything. I don't need to do anything except get used to it. That's it. As the teacher Punjaji said, they asked him, what's the best way? He said, just be quiet. That's the very best way. In practice, no teacher, no teaching, no student. No teaching, no teacher, no student. No teaching, no teacher, no student. Okay, which means full stop in the wow. Just full stop in the wow. That our true nature is the teaching. Is the teacher, and it is the student. Yeah. We're just like the audience member. Just be quiet. Get used to it. Don't ask questions. Don't confront. Full stop. Your mind is full stop. It's not asking questions. It's not confronting. It's not competing. It's not dreaming. It's not scheming. It's not planning the future. It's just saying, wow, this is great. I mean, let me get used to this. Let me get used to this. Now, nature's frantically trying to compete with supernature. And the psychic projections to motivate ourselves to do this that we have made, we call them the goddess. We call them God, Jehovah God. The Jehovah God is the one that, you know, if you don't do this, I'm gonna, you know, and we kind of gotten tired of that, so now we're using the goddess to sell ourselves on trying to compete and try to make nature more attractive to us than reality. Which is what's happening right now is you know, we go back and forth between the God and the goddess, the God and the goddess. And these are the psychic projections that how we market lies to ourselves, the packaging that we put the lies in. So we packaged it as an angry, bellicose, jealous, insecure God that says, you better do this or I'm gonna, you know, smite you. And we packaged it that way for a while to keep us motivated, keep working on this, trying to make this world, using these bio-robots to make the, you know, trying to make this world more attractive than reality to spirit, you know. And then we realize, wow, we just can't do it. We don't seem to be doing it. And then we say, what do we do? What do we do? We're so frightened. We'll be annihilated if we don't do this. So they say, oh, yeah, let's repackage it as the goddess. So we repackage it as the goddess, which it was the packaging before. We packaged it as God, you see. So we packaged the self-deception, the lies, as the goddess. Okay, and so now the goddess is this motivational force in the globe here, on this planet, that is the new motivational force, the new packaging. It's being repackaged from previous. So those of us that have long memories realize, no, this is the same old packaging. You know, God. It just changed the color of the ribbon. You know, put a blue ribbon, then put a pink ribbon on it. It's the same. So this goddess then is like a packaging of self-deception. And it will come to us and say, hey, you know, you need to, you can make nature, you can make it even more attractive than the invitation of SuperNature. Let's work on that. Let's work on making, how can we be more attractive? Let's make a more attractive invitation. And they say, you're supposed to be doing that. Come on, you got to compete with it. Get inspired. Get fired. You can get inspired. And then we take our attention off of SuperNature. Take our attention off the invitation. This is the problem. I've been there and done that for sure. Because our packaging of self-deception can seem very glamorous and very attractive, you know, because we want it to be attractive. We want to believe that it's more attractive to spirit than our true home. So certainly the world is caught up in that and will be caught up in that. That's another cycle. You see, until we get tired of this packaging, the packaging of the goddess, say, wow, still futile, didn't work. And then we'll, you know, repackage it again as the god. The angry god. And said, wow, sugar didn't do it. Now let's use the carrot didn't do it. Now let's use the stick, you know. It's the carrot and the stick. We keep trying to see what's going to work. Nothing works. We cannot make this fantasy of a co-reality, of a co-necessity, to be a co-reality. We cannot make that more attractive than the one reality is to us. Because there's only one reality. There's only one all. One is one eternal life, always. That's all there is. So this fantasy of some co-reality, we can't make it more attractive than reality to us. We keep saying, tired of this, that's ridiculous. But we tell ourselves that if we stop doing this, we'll be annihilated. God will annihilate us. Why? Because all of this entails planning, which we call time. Trying to structure moments as if they're connected. Saying, I have to do this. I have to do this, or I'll cease to exist. Because saying there's a co-reality, well, obviously this co-reality has to be different than reality, and reality is this absolute freedom. So how could be? What is different than absolute freedom? Non-freedom. And what is non-freedom? It means moments would be joined, that one moment determines the next in some way. It's like a chain. And that chain is what we believe is our life. That we're imagining there's this chain called time, space, process, and form, where moments are joined, you see. And this is what we have worked on, we come up with finally nature. This is what we've come up with. Where it seems that life is dependent upon this chain of little minute, little events happening like that. You see, it's determined. The seed determines, you know, the tree. And we call this life. No, this is something that we worked on to come up with an alternative reality to reality. But it's all actually imaginary. So we feel that this is our life. This is the co-reality. And we believe that God mandated we do this. So if we drop it and realize, oh, it was never there, we feel we'll be annihilated because we think this identity is dependent upon this. To create a separate reality, a co-reality that's different than reality. And if we fail at this, then we'll fail at our function. Then God will say, well, you have no function then. You see, you have no function, which means annihilation, right? This is what this lie that we're telling ourselves, and it scares us. So we pray to the God, or they pray to the goddess, you know, the packaging of self-deception. Like, please keep us motivated. Please keep us motivated. You know, so... Of course, we fall into the arms of the God. Say, got to say, please keep me motivated. I'm so scared. Keep me motivated. I gotta keep believing this world is more attractive than reality. Otherwise, I'll drop it. And if I drop it, I feel I'm going to be, you know, have no function. I'll be annihilated. This is our fear. None of this is true. It's absolute nonsense. Our function is pure freedom. In other words, no moment is ever set for us. Nothing is ever set for us. That means we can have everything at any moment. All pure potential is available to us every instant. Available to all. All pure potential for everything that is always available to all every instant. This is reality. This is reality. All riches, see, are always ours. All riches are always ours. A supernature is just a reminder of that. It's a symbol of this. It's still a symbol. It's still an illusion. It's still a symbol. But it's the symbol. It's the final symbol. It's the symbol where we don't need any other symbols at all. And then we can set that symbol down. Eventually, at some point. When we're ready. Which doesn't take that long. So the symbol of supernature, the symbol of treasure, all treasure, wow. Everything is completely the same, fresh. I saw it, I realized everything here, the appearance of all these trees, exactly the same as it's always been. Okay, little interruption. We're just sort of going over this, go over it, go over it, go over it, so it gets clearer and clearer and clearer. Now, how long do we want to stay with such an invitation? 2 seconds? 3, 4, 5 minutes, 2 minutes, three. Well, hopefully we'd want to stay as long as possible. If it's an internal invitation, if you're aware of this invitation, which supernature can give us this invitation here. Absolutely it can. You want to stay with it as long as possible, of course. So that's what we're practicing. Now, I've experienced this before, and what happened was there's this voice, like a female voice, like a mother goddess, yelling at my name, yelling at me, like alarmed, and that's I broke away attention. What like that? And then I lost it. You see, this is what happens. You think, oh, whoa, you know, 'cause you used to have your mother when there's like, you know, like you're a child and you're in a dangerous place. The mother, hey, get away from the street. You know, yells at you. Oh, you reacted. Oh, I'm close. So what happens when the imitation of supernature arrives, this defensive system, that's self-deception that tells us we're going, if we don't plan our future, we'll have no function, we'll be annihilated, gets all freaked out. Says, hey, get your attention off of that. You lost track of where you were and what time it was. You see, the mother's always telling you, it teaches you as you're a child to, okay, where are you? Always know where you are. Always know who you are, what your name is. Always know what, you know, time of the day it is. You know, be oriented to this world. They teach you how to be oriented to this world. So you have this sort of inner mother that reacts when you lose track of time, space, process, and form, which you do when you see the invitation, when you're experiencing the invitation of supernature. Time, space, process, and form. Where am I doesn't matter. What time, what day it is, what time it is, doesn't matter. What my name is, what doesn't matter. None of them, what my future plans are, don't matter. See? So this inner mother voice will start yelling at you like, hey, hey, like alarm's going off, alarm bell's going off. Absolutely. In fact, I've had many such experiences like this. It's very frustrating because you say, wow, no, I don't want to pay attention to that, telling me, orient yourself in time, space, process, and form. And I say, no, this is more important than that. Not now, maybe later. So you say, not now, Mom, maybe later. It's like that. Not now, Goddess, maybe later. And if you don't pay attention to the Mom, then the Goddess will show up more beautiful. Just pay attention to me. Look how wonderful I am. I have something very important for you. Or she'll say, great. You know, oh, she said, oh, you just had a moment, you know, of imitation. That's so great now. And now you need to use that to become, I'll turn you into some super guru, some super teacher. Because now, you see, you detach from the invitation. And what do you lose? Familiarity. familiarity is what you lose. It's not about just one instant. It's about getting familiar. Certainly, little instants are helpful, but that's moving you towards greater and greater capacity to stay with it longer and longer and get familiar. We think, wow, if I can just please the goddess, please the mother goddess, enough, she won't bother me. She'll promise that to you. Just say, listen, I won't disturb you again in the future if you just, you know, if you can just calm me down, you know. So I'm not worried, so I'm sure that, you know, you're okay. Okay, mom, I'll try to do everything I can do to please you. And then, of course, you spend all your time trying to make this world more attractive than reality. Failure. So trying to appease the goddess is a path of failure. It's a trick. Of course, she makes a false promise. She says, I won't bother you again. Well, the more you get used to serving the goddess, the more that she'll demand. You know, the more your continuity fear gets worse and worse. And then, so the more you need this self-deception, feel you need it. So the more interruption there will be, so it gets worse. So we're just bringing this to light and just looking at it. This comes not from theory, but from actual practice, actual experience here. This is what happens. We get distracted. We make false promises to ourselves, and we package those false promises in very clever ways, whether it's the god or the goddess, or combination. They call it the god-goddess. And the packaging, both, you know, two ribbons on the package of self-deception, of false promises. Threats and intimidation, scare tactics. We just assume that if the mother's screaming at us, that something very dangerous is we're in great danger. It's not true. We're not in great danger at all. Remember, the essential lie we're telling ourselves is if we give up trying to make an imaginary co-reality more attractive than reality to us, that will be annihilated because we won't have any function. So this fear, the lie we're telling ourselves, is that we'll be annihilated if we're not oriented in time, space, process, and form. So there is no danger whatsoever. Spirit is not oriented in time, space, process, and form at all. Isn't orientation is I am. All is. All is eternal life. All is pleasure. There's no question of orientation in any nonsense of time, space, process, and form. Every moment is free and clear. Every other moment, there's no such thing as planning your life as a future that this is what I have to be. Or, you know, not like that. There's a flowing. There's not a mental planning of like time. Like I have to do this in order to be. I don't have to do anything in particular in order to be. I don't have to be any quote unquote particular place in order to be. In order for all to be, all is always. Wherever I go, I'm exactly where I've always been. Whatever I do, I'm doing exactly what I've always done. Whatever I am, I'm exactly what I've always been. So, in practicing, we get these little invitations, little glimpses, and then we fail to hold on to it. Practice full stop in the wow of the invitation. Don't struggle with the fact that I, you know, kind of disassociate a little bit. Say, okay, continuity fear just flared up. Fine, full stop in that. Just be quiet. Don't berate yourself. Don't get angry. Just say, oh, okay, that's the continuity fear. Fine. I don't need anything more than just to recognize that. I don't need to get into an argument with the goddess, the goddess. I don't need to ask for promises from them. I know it's all false. All that is false. I simply have a continuity fear. That's why I detached from it. That's it. So the practice becomes very simple. And since it becomes simple, it becomes very rapid. The progress becomes very rapid. Because we insist that we only have one problem. There's no other problem I have. It's the continuity problem. So all I need to do is focus on that. And how do I work on that? Don't struggle. Don't conflate it. Just recognize. I got a little shaken up. I said, I need to know where I am. This bogus fear, you know, I lack familiarity with this. Okay, I accept that. I lack familiarity with this. I accept it. Just accept it like that. Nothing more. And then I lack familiarity with this. Okay. So let me let the jitters calm down a little bit. And then faith, it will return. As the invitation will return as we practice this way. Since there are no threats whatsoever in supernature where you are, it's always free from threats. So where am I? I'm free from threats is where I am. Since my identity is never threatened by supernature, what am I? I am never threatened by loss of identity. What am I doing? I need to do nothing to sustain this or maintain it or create it. Therefore, it doesn't matter what I'm doing. What am I? So I don't need to be planning or scheming. You might say, I'm practicing no threat whatsoever, no vulnerability to what I am at all. Everless invulnerability. I'm practicing the invitation to everless invulnerability. No matter how vulnerable you feel in this world, we can still practice invitation, getting familiar with the invitation, invulnerability. Absolutely, everyone can. No matter what their circumstance or situation seems to be. Need to do nothing about that in order to practice this. You might say, well, my situation is terrible, it's horrible. Well, there's a realm where none of that is possible. And you can certainly practice getting used to the invitation to that realm. The only way you'll get into the realm is if you feel familiar enough, saying, yeah, okay. I remember you went to this place, and I thought, hey, this place is wonderful, I'd like to move here. But I said, no, I can't. This is too nice a place. So I ended up going back again and again and again, practicing, trying to get used to the place. So I felt like, you know what, I could live here, even though it's such wonderful, I'm used to it now. And it works. They said, I'm familiar with this place enough so it feels like home to me. It feels like home. I'm ready to go today. It feels like home. Whereas the first time I went, I said, there's no way. This is too good for me. So this is a great example of how familiarity, working on familiarity, is so potent. Because you can take a situation that feels too good for you, and through gradually getting used to it, getting used to go back, return again and again to it, with some breaks in between, you'll gradually feel, hey, I feel at home here. I feel like I'm used to this now. I can live here. Yes, I can. And then the others who don't do that, they'll sour grape it. They'll say, nah, I don't like that place. I never want to go to that place. I don't like that place. Meaning, they're afraid of experiencing this, you know, this feeling of us. They think it's too good for them. They don't want to believe there's any place that's better than their, you know, this world here, the nature, this terrible place. They want to make this more attractive than reality is to them. So they don't want to be aware. But yeah, when you come across a place that is way better than what you're used to, way, way better, the first reaction is like, whoa, wow. And then you say, how fortunate those are to live here. I'd never be able to live here. But then you feel so attracted, you say, you know what? Someday I want to live here. I'm going to work on this. I'm going to see what I can do. And so you come back, and you come back, and you come back, and there, and just gradually it seeps into you, and you feel like, I'm getting more and more familiar with this place. And just like sit there, I just sit there and quietly get used to it. What's the ultimate is to realize you don't need this world of nature anymore. You don't need it. The world of nature was only so you could pursue a function that God didn't give you, an imaginary function that we thought we created for ourselves. That's the only reason this whole world and universe is appearing, so we could pursue this function, believing that we can create a co-reality. See, we're co-creators with God, but not creators of a co-reality. You see, so this, when you realize I don't really need this world anymore, then the last tricky part, you know, is no longer tricky. There's nothing we need to do with this world at all. What happens to this world doesn't matter, because this world was only in support of trying to develop a function that God didn't give us, you see. And we realize that we don't need to do that. God will not annihilate us. God did not create us to develop a new function that God did not give us. And God didn't say, if you fail at this, you're going to be annihilated. And we think, so, well, if we don't develop a new function, then how do we function? Well, we function the way God created us to function, of course. So we're not without a function if we fail to develop a new function that God did not give us. So we're not annihilated if we fail to do, if we set this down. So if we set the world down, which is just what a prop we're using to try and help us develop this function, we don't need it. We don't need it. We're not free of annihilation anymore. See, this is just reason. This is just reason. It's just using reason. This world is just an appearance that's appearing to try to help us develop this new function that God did not create us with. That's all. So that's why we think we need it. But when we realize, oh, I don't need to develop a new function, I can just use the one that God gave me, then we don't need this world. We don't need it. Don't need it. Don't need it at all. So it doesn't matter. The world doesn't matter in any way, shape, or form. Then what happens to it doesn't matter. And then we don't need it at all. What happens is it just ceases to arise eventually. Out of pure potentiality. No need for it to rise anymore. No need for this nature to be rising as a play out of pure potentiality. It's a very bizarre arising for sure. It tried to help us develop a function that God didn't create us with. That's very bizarre. We certainly won't do that anymore. We can if we want, but it's unlikely we will. That's for sure. Knowing that it brings about this fear of annihilation. Ah, no, that's been there, done that. Once is enough, I would say. But again, the pure potentiality, no residue, no judgment from God whatsoever. None. So if we want to, we certainly can. It's very unlikely anyone will, that's for sure. So this is opening the door a little more. What we're doing is we're opening the door just a little bit at a time. Each video I've done seems to open the door a little more. And so it brings up a wow in me, like, wow, this door's really getting more open than it was. Wow. The door. How do you get an invitation of supernature if your door's shut? If you're defended against it. But here we're opening the door a little more, allowing the breeze to come in. The breeze to come in. Breeze of supernature, allowing it to come into this world. Into this so-called, into our awareness, let's put it that way, into our awareness. And the thing is, about breeze, is it's sort of like a pressure gradient, whereas if you just barely open, it doesn't really come in. You have to open the door enough. So there's some sort of shift in pressure gradient, and then it starts flowing in. The invitation starts flowing into you. And that's what we're nervous about. Say, wow, I opened the door a little more, and I wonder if the breeze is going to start flowing. All the mother goddesses, inner and interiorized mother goddess, a packaging of self-deception in the world, is going to be screaming at you, saying, stay away from that breeze, stay away. You'll be annihilated, you know, saying that. But again, how can we be annihilated if we simply fail to create a function for us that God did not create for us? When failure to do that leaves us with what? With the function that God created for us, still perfectly intact, immaculately intact, which is absolute freedom, perfect bliss, peace, harmony, oneness, eternal life. So how can we suffer annihilation? We cannot. It's ridiculous. We just made up the belief that if we fail it to create a function that God did not create us with, that we'll be annihilated. God will annihilate us. This is just a motivational scare tactic we used. That's all. And since God created us with the function of absolute freedom forever, that will still be there. How could God say, you failed to create a different, separate function of lack of freedom for yourself, so I'm going to take perfect freedom away from you? That's obviously totally insane, because we are God. So basically, perfect freedom is God. So we're saying that God would annihilate God if we don't somehow create a separate, different function of no freedom for us, for God. You know, that's obviously, it's crazy. And this is the craziness we fail to see as craziness. So we're opening the door a little more, opening the window, you know. Let the breeze in, let the breeze in. Breeze of remembrance, let the breeze of remembrance, breeze of the invitation to supernature, let it in. It's there. We just have to let this pressure gradient, which is the lessen the continuity fear until some threshold is crossed and it starts to flow. We'd like to get flowing in some way in this world by January 1st, roundabout, you know, just as a nice round figure there to start the new year, start the 18-month period before compliance with the new world order, with the incorporate, Earth Incorporated, we call it Earth Incorporated, before compliance is expected, demanded by July 2016, which is likely to be around that time where there will be a general agreement in the world that we all need to comply now. And the time of thinking, should I comply, should I not, is over. It is, yes, we must comply. You know, we've got so many things we need to do here. The world is having problems. We've got to fix these problems, maybe, because the world's not being attractive enough to us. So everybody needs to comply with the effort to make this world more attractive in reality. Not even equal, because if it's equal, we might go back to reality, so we might make it more attractive, you know. And so this desperate attempt to create a function for ourselves that God did not create, we try to make this, you know, we try to make it succeed, completely futile. So we're really trying to make futility, total futility, along with the fear of annihilation, we're trying to make that more attractive to us than the absolute freedom, peace, safety, love, bliss of home. I'm trying to make it more attractive. And this is the Earth Incorporated, this is its goal. They want compliance with this effort, full compliance with this effort. So we had better have some familiarity with invitation to supernature by that time. We better have it. If we don't practice it by that time, when we said, whoa, I don't want to comply. Oh my gosh, what are my options? Supernature, well, I'm not familiar with that. Whoops. And we took the daredevil approach of no practice, of just leaping instead of practicing first. Instead of preparing, we say, oh, I'm completely unprepared. Well, then I have to leap. You know, whoops, fear of annihilation. Wait a minute, you know, this is too good for me. I'm stuck. And the goddess is telling everyone, don't worry, you don't have to practice. Don't have to practice. When you get to that, don't worry, I'll turn you into like a super guru, you know, and so everyone will love you, and you'll motivate them to work to get it, to telling them you can get it, you can make this world even more attractive than supernature, don't worry. So the goddess is whispering to everyone right now, you don't need to practice, don't worry. Everything will be fine, just don't have to practice. But I will elevate you when you find out, oh, I'm not ready, I can't go to supernature, I'm afraid of a continuity problem. She'll say, oh, that's because you don't want to, because I have a better role for you here. So you're not rejecting it because of the continuity problem. You're rejecting it because I have a better role for you here. I'm going to make you like a super great teacher, savior, guru of the world, to inspire the world. You'll be an inspiration of the world to work, to practice, to get work, not practice, but to work to get into compliance. I'll make you a compliance guru. I'll use you to inspire the world to get into compliance, full compliance, so we can work on making this world more attractive than SuperNature even. And you'll say, oh, wow, yeah. This is what the God has been whispering in our ear, whispering in our ear, whispering, and everyone's deep down whispering to us, saying, don't practice. You don't have to. I have something better for you. That's the booby prize, he says. I got something better for you. So, you know, many, those who listen to the guidance will not be prepared. The continuity, when they try to leap, so the continuity fear will hit them, and then they'll have this defense system, all this rationalization all set up, and say, oh yeah, that's right, I'm not supposed to go there because I have a higher role, a better role. I'm even greater than that. I don't need that. Sour grapes. Sour grape, but I'm better than that. I have this better role to inspire compliance. Oh yeah. Ready for that. This is what happens. So you have 18 months to dump the goddess. Tell the goddess goodbye. Or say, not now, maybe later, goddess, not now. I'm practicing, don't bother me. Dump the goddess. A liar, deceiver, and a murderess from the very beginning, actually. Right? So dump the goddess. To say, not now, maybe later. You know, the breakup, he's sobbing, no, I have such a great role for you. You'll be able to inspire compliance. Everybody will, you'll be a hero of the revolution. We'll have statues of you, you know. And, say, not now, goddess, maybe later. Not now, don't take her calls. She's calling you on the phone, you know, broke up with her. She's worried you might be breaking up with her. And you say, don't answer the phone. Or you can answer and say, oh, sorry, not now. I can't talk right now. I'm busy. Maybe later. I'm practicing. Maybe later. Okay? Not now. You got to break up with the goddess. Absolutely. Because that's what's trying to inspire you to not go to supernature, to reject that. Instead, try to take on a role of inspiring the world to be in full compliance with Earth Incorporated. His goal is to make this world, nature, more attractive than supernature, more attractive than reality even. Otherwise, in the fear, you'll be annihilated if you don't succeed at this. So, break up with the goddess, dump the goddess, say not now goddess, later. Maybe later, maybe later, maybe later. Which means also maybe not later too, right? Dump the goddess. And having been through this, I know it's not that easy, is it? But you can do it. I'm doing it. You can do it too. Absolutely. Goddess played me for a fool. Which is my own continuity fear. Played me for a fool. Plays all of us for a fool. Plays all of us for a fool. For a while. For a while. But gradually you start getting wise to it. You know, say, hey, wait a minute. If I just start practicing, I don't really need this goddess, do I? No. I don't need to be a performer, do I? No, I don't. I don't need to be a performer. I could be an audience member. Supernature, just being there is enough. Just being there is enough. It's all perfect. It's all fresh. It's all untainted. It's no corruption. There's nothing, none of the cycles of nature at all. Wow. Every moment, it can stay the same, can stay the same, can stay the same. Every moment's unbound from the previous one. So I can just have it stay the same. I don't have to have it change, actually, at all. Pure potentiality doesn't get tired if you want to keep the same, same. There's no inevitable change as far as the next moment has to be different than this one. No, it doesn't. This moment is not determining a difference of the next moment. This moment is not, it's not part of a process. There's no process in supernature. There's no process taking place. There's no process taking place. No process taking place. Process free. That's what's most important. So seems like everything looks the same. That's what I realized. Hey, everything here has looked the same forever. Wow. I could tell that nothing has changed here. No process has ever taken place here. So no process is actually a symbol of absolute freedom, which is not bound. I see here, this nature is inevitable. Here, where we look, there's just an inexorable process is taking place, seemingly, right? Can't stop them. Can't seem to stop them. Whereas in supernature, there's no process taking place at all. But it maintains the forms of nature. The trees, the lakes. It's like a park. It's like a beautiful, awesome park, actually. But there's no process that's taking place. This park that you're seeing is looks the same as it's always looked and will always look the same too. There's no process of change taking place. As I said before in other videos, there may be just some faint traces of that just for the sake of continuity fear. Like it may seem like something that's gotten a little bit bigger maybe over time, but it's still the same form. This tree is where it's always been. This is where it's always been. No death has ever taken place there. None whatsoever. No reproduction has ever taken place. No death has ever taken place. Everything that is there has been there always. This tree, this flower, this shrub, everything has been there from the very beginning of this idea of supernature. Nothing has vanished from the scene at all. Nothing has been replaced at all. Nothing at all. So you see this tree and you realize, wow, this tree's been there from the very beginning. It will always be there. And everything else is just like that too. It's a whole different experience. So I said, wow. Because here we look and realize that everything we're seeing is not is going to be gone and replaced with something else. Everything. As if never to return, you see? What kind of freedom is that? What if we want something? Say, I want a tree. I want you to stay there. For, you know, billions of years, exactly as you are right now. I just want to be exactly as you are right now. Each moment. No, I don't want you to be replaced. Oh no, nature doesn't allow that, does it? See, it doesn't allow that. But supernature is a symbol of our freedom. Our freedom to do that. If we want to, see? There's nothing determinate in reality at all. Reality is exactly what we want it to be. Moment by moment by moment. That's a supernature is a way of reminding us this, that we keep it with, and it helps evaporate our continuity fear. So we're using the symbols of nature. We use the symbols of nature without the process being there. See, absolute freedom is not a process. It's never a process. It's never a process. So it's never time. It's never a blueprint. It's never a process. It's never a structure. The moments are not structured. There's no binding moments of structure. Whatever we want is moment by moment by moment. Reality is whatever we want it to be moment by moment by moment. Always free for each moment to be something else. Entirely if we want it. It can be exactly the same or it can be entirely different each moment. And then it can go back to what it was before. Everything completely free. But the intermediate step first, get used to, no process at all. Wow, that's cool. No inexorable process at all. Nature free of process, free of all process. Just is. All these beautiful trees and park, this park, beautiful park, just is. There's no process taking place. Death-free realm. So dump the goddess. Dump the goddess. This is my advice. She tries to interfere with your practicing. Does say, not now, goddess. God says, no, you need to react to this. Not now, goddess. Maybe later. I'm just enjoying this. That's all. I'm getting familiar with it. God says, now you need to be inspired and express your inspiration. Not now, goddess, maybe later. I'm just enjoying this. nothing I need to do. I don't need to respond. I don't need to do anything. Just enjoy it. Yeah, but you need to make some poetry, some book, or something. No, not now, guys. Maybe later. But of course, she knows she's being dumb. She gets frantic. This will come back again and again and again and again and again and again and again. Gradually, you just have to keep practicing. Not now, goddess, maybe later. Just full stop on the now. Well, can you at least explain why you're breaking? No, not now, maybe later. I'm practicing this. Well, why are you practicing? Not now. No explanation. I'm practicing full stop in the now. It means there's no explanation. Don't not need it. SuperNature doesn't need an explanation. But what about nature? No, don't need it. Don't need futility. What about futility? Don't need it. I have a function, God-given function, and I'm going back to getting used to that. So not now, maybe later. But what about all the great roles I have for you to play in history? Not now, maybe later. I'm not talking about that now. Full stop. Oh, maybe you like the God better. No, not now, maybe later. I'm dumping futility, no matter what package it's in. I'm dumping it. It's not now, maybe later, because I'm in a process of familiarity. It's the final process. It's the process of familiarity with no process. That's the final process. So we're daring to prepare. We're daring to not be daredevils, see? We're daring to dump the daredevilness. Daring to practice. This is the ultimate dare. Dare to practice. If you really want to be courageous and daring, dare to practice so you don't need to be a daredevil, because that will fail. So dare to accept the invitation of SuperNature. That's what's really daring. That's the real daring, isn't it? Dare to accept the invitation of SuperNature. The rest are too afraid. They're not daring at all. They're frightened. Cowards, you know, frightened. They didn't practice. So they'll reject and sour grape it. It's doubt. That's a terrible place. I'm not going to go there. Are you kidding? I have a higher calling here. Say that SuperNature is my only function. Vision of Oneness is my only function here. That's all I need to do. Accept the invitation is all I need to do. That's it. All right. Dump the goddess. By all means, you have my full permission to dump the goddess. You'll be in good company when you do that. That is for sure. Because that's the new packaging, right? That's the deepest packaging, because it ties in with our vulnerability as this form, robot, bio-robot form. Vulnerability as your young child, you know, the mother protecting you from vulnerability. So when the mother's voice calls out to you, you know, shrieks at you, you're in danger, you know. You like react. Oh, we're taught to just automatically, you know, instinctively react that way or something. So dump the goddess. Dump the goddess. Dump the goddess. You'll be in very good company when you do that. Very good company. And by doing it, don't do it all at once. Say, well, not now, goddess. Maybe later. Not now. Maybe later. I'm busy. I'm practicing full stop in the wow. So, if you want to label, you can say. The goddess says, well, I'm a wowist now. I'm a wowist. I'm not a goddess worshiper, I'm a wowist. Oh, because she'll try to get into you. I will explain. I'm just a wowist. I'm practicing. What do? I practice full stop in the wow. That's it. Now. Bye-bye. Not now. Later. Baby later. Not So we're getting there. We're getting there. We're getting closer. And I feel tremendous buzz, spiritual buzz from this video. Tremendous. I usually keep the videos going until I feel a tremendous spiritual buzz. So I know if I'm getting it, it's likely that most of you are getting it. There may be some that are beyond me and not even getting a spiritual buzz. That's fine. They need to then find some way to get a spiritual buzz. Find something even more potent. That's fine. For me, I'm going as fast as I can, and it's probably likely this is pretty much as fast as most of us need to go, you know. And if there's those that are even more advanced, go faster. By all means, go faster, faster. Please don't let me stall you out in any way. Don't need to pay any attention to me. Certainly, I'm feeling this. This is, you know, just, you know, heavy, heavy territory we have covered. It's very daring. Very, very daring. We're opening that door even more. We're opening the window quite a bit more. It's like daring, you know, for that breeze to come in. Come on, I'm ready. You come on in. It's at the same time, like, whoa, might be too nice for me. I don't know. Very daring. Very daring. So, it's great. Dare to practice. All right, so we got to wind down. How do we wind down a little bit from this buzz back to function, you know, functionality of some sort here? Okay, talk about the weather. Talk about the Christmas lights. Talk about it rained today. Started raining. I went to a weather website, some are better than others, and it said it's going to start. Yesterday was like in the evening. I went to this website and it said it's going to start raining in 5 minutes. I was just outside and it wasn't. I said, "When's it going to start raining?" He says, "It'll start raining in rain in 5 minutes." It said, "Rain in 5 minutes." So I waited like 5 minutes checking other stuff. Then I went outside and son of a gun, started a little drizzling was starting. There, it was accurate exactly to the minute. Rain in 5 minutes. And this morning, it showed. Showed that it was going to stop raining in about 10 minutes or so. It was pouring down, just pouring. And so I said, you know, guys, it's going to stop pouring in about 10 minutes and then we'll have a break for, you know, like a several hour break and we'll get to do what we need to do. And it did. It stopped raining. It was great. So I have this radar and then they're somehow able to correlate the radar with, you know, the timing, hourly. Can be pretty accurate if you're up to date on the radar, but of course the radar can shift and change. They're extrapolating based on what the radar is showing them at this particular moment, and that doesn't always correlate. We're having a break now. We got quite a bit of rain today, quite a bit of rain. Tomorrow is supposed to be even more in the afternoon, which is great. Almost an inch tomorrow they're expecting. Absolutely fantastic. Keep sending all the rain this way. We'll take an inch a day, please. We have to get an inch a day. That might help out. That would help out. And the buzz is still intense. Very intense. Just thought so. Well, we'll leave that for another time. We're trying to wind down. Trying to wind this down. Or at least mellow it out a little bit. intense. Putting this video up for everyone world to see. Very intense, of course. Very intense. But don't worry about it. Just practice. That's all we need to do. All right. So we've sat in one place. We haven't got anything. We haven't done anything. Now we got to go back to the world and well, do what? I don't know what I'll do. try to do nothing. Get this video up online. That's what I'll do. All right. Very great. That's it.